focus on some of the important topics and happenings in the section of science and technology. The first one is Dickinsonia. Now, Dickinsonia is the earliest known living animal fossil that has been found around 550 million years old in the regions of Bhimbetka rock shelters. Now, Dickinsonia has been first appearing in the region from 541 million to 571 million. They were discovered as an the fossil is a kind of extinct basal animal which lived during the Icardian period, not only in India but also in the regions of Ukraine, Australia and Russia, showing that these countries were united at some point of time. So definitely there was one common land which was seen. Earliest part of multicellular complex life on our earth have been revealed from the fossils that have been obtained. The fossils have been very, very important because this fossil has shown radial symmetry, that is the kind of symmetry that exists in the body plan. Also, it is diploblastic, that is, it is derived from two embryonic cell layers, and the kind of the body is very, very simple. Also, it has cholesterol molecules which support an idea that Dickinsonia was not a plant but an animal fossil. Now, the discoveries have been important. As we said, it is 550 million years ago, or mega annum. Mega annum is equal to 1 million year. So we can also say it is 550 mega annum. Now, Bhimbetka caves are one of the ancient prehistoric caves discovered as a part of Paleolithic and Mesolithic period, and V.S. Vankarkar basically found the Bhimbetka rocks shelter regions in the region of Hoshangabad and regions of Bhopal. The evidence of Stone Age has been supported here, and earliest traces of human life in India have also been found in the regions of Bhimbetka. So Bhimbetka in the regions of Hoshangabad and the regions of Bhopal have been very important in themselves. It is also a part of UNESCO World Heritage Site, which consists of 7 hills and nearly 750 rock shelters in the area. Bhimbetka is also known for its paintings. The red and white paintings on the cave walls have been very, very interesting, and signs of dancing, singing, hunting have been found in these cave paintings. The next is clean fuel, hydrogen. Definitely, if we are able to derive hydrogen as a fuel, it is very, very easier, because we have huge amount of hydrogen that is present. But how to extract hydrogen? So recently we have devised a method where sulfur ion thermochemical hydrogen cycle, which is known as SI cycle, can be done. But the only thing is, this would require high amount of heat, and the high amount of heat would be required for separating this hydrogen from the oxygen, because we are trying to derive hydrogen from the water molecules. So if you want to separate hydrogen from oxygen through the process of sulfur iodine thermochemical process, we would be requiring lots of heat. So how we can reduce this is through a catalyst that can be introduced. A catalyst is nothing but which just activates or speeds up the process of reaction, and therefore the rate of heat generation could be increased, and the corrosive steps for sulfuric acid conversion to sulfur dioxide and oxygen could be enhanced through the use of the catalyst. So this discovery would definitely change the world. Now, hydrogen has been is important because if it is used as fuel, definitely it is non-toxic, it is environmental friendly, it is more beneficial for spaceships, rocket launches. Also, there are numerous benefits in terms of abundance. It is highly abundant, but there are disadvantages. Firstly, it is odorless. So if there is any leakage, it would be very difficult to detect because you cannot smell it. Also, transportation is very, very difficult because it is highly volatile and inflammable in nature. Through the process of sulfur iodine cycle, what we call as SI cycle, which is high temperature endothermic reaction, which requires heat, there would be the idea where hydrogen extraction could become much more successful and viable option. The next is Bhuvan portal. Now India with MapMyIndia and ISRO along with MapMyIndia has come up with an indigenous geospatial portal which is known as Bhuvan. Through this we would have access of editing, displaying and analyzing the geospatial data. So better privacy, better reflection of the government interface and data would be brought. Numerous data sets would be used for identifying and building the whole of the data set. Lot of data would also be used from NAVIC, which is Navigation and Indian Constellation, the various web services which would be using API. And MapMyIndia is an Indian company in alternative to Google Maps, which covers nearly 7.5 lakh Indian villages and 750 cities and has a data of road network of around 63 lakh kilometers. So with this huge database, definitely we can come up with a good option, and Bhuvan portal is one of the answers to that. Now what is NAVIC? NAVIC is again important. NAVIC is an Indian regional navigation satellite system which comprises of 8 satellites. 3 of the satellites are in the geostationary orbit, 5 of those are in geosynchronous orbit, and they are basically established similar to the US GPS system. The certification is done by third generation partnership project and therefore is important. Now once the data is received, it could be used for numerous purpose. It can be used for planning, it can be used for mapping, it can be used for disaster management and other important developments. Now similar to this navigation system, we have other world navigation systems which are here. For example, in Europe we have Galileo, in China it's Baidu, Russia has GLONASS and Japan has QuEST. So those are some of the major navigational systems across the globe. The next is Sandesh. This is a government messaging app and this is very very similar to your WhatsApp app. This has been launched by the National Informatics Center and most of the important features here would be message forwarding, broadcasting, making groups and having emojis. The next is Bheem Bamboo Crash Barriers, a very very innovative development which has been done by Vishweshwarya National Institute of Technology. The idea so far is on the highways accidental deaths are very common. So this is a low cost alternative to the steel barriers that are put in order to reduce the accident deaths on highways. Now Bheema or Bheema Bamboo is a bamboo which is engineered and made much more durable, stronger than the traditional bamboos, and it is a kind of clone of the traditional bamboos mainly from northeast. So this bamboo variety usually grows in the regions of south and mainly the areas of Karnataka and vicinity, and this would be costing one third less than the steel barriers that are erected along the highways. Now along with the Bheem bamboo, what else would be used? Coir would be used. Coir is the coconut fiber. It is also known as kayar in Tamil, or which actually means rod or kind of rope. So this is another important fiber that would be used along with Bheema bamboo. Now both of them have been important because as we said, it is low cost, it is more tensile resistant, it is more elastic, and the weight is significantly lesser as compared, the weight and the cost is significantly less, and this can minimize the impact of highway accidents by providing a good cushioning. So that is one of the developments that we have seen. The next is nanobodies. Nanobodies, as we have seen, can fight against COVID-19. So surface proteins of the coronavirus were injected in alpaca and llama, and their immune systems produced antibodies which could serve as actually nanobodies. So this new approach could help in creating effective antibodies, and this process would be more or less irreversible, because if virus is no longer being able to bind to the host cells, then there is no probability for infection that can occur. So antibody is one of the best weapons as immunity or as a defense or protection system against any virus. So these nanobodies would have two variants, the VL and the VH variant, and those are the two variants that we conventionally see in any of the antibodies. Now nanobodies would have VHH dominance that would be seen, and VL domain would actually lack. So absence of VL domain is also an indication that these nanobodies are actually hydrophilic. That means they have a tendency to dissolve on the side of water, and this indicates that there does not exist any issues with terms of solubility, and therefore have good results. There, similarly, we have seen impacts with monoclonal antibodies. Tocilizumab is one of the good examples. We have covered those in one of the separate lectures. The next is the various testings that have been done for COVID-19. Now, among the various testings that have been done for COVID-19, we have seen that either a nasal swab is taken or a oral swab is taken. Both of those are very, very difficult and irritating rather. Also, there can be chances of contamination or improper sampling if not taken properly. So, in order to avoid that, a new test has been devised, and this has been authorized by US Food and Drug Administration, and that is based on saliva. So with the saliva, this test can be done, and this is known as a saliva direct test. Its sensitivity is very, very high, extremely helpful in detecting the copies of the virus, and much more simpler, much more easier to conduct. The next is lumpy skin disease. We have already covered this in our edition of Down to Earth. Now, this is a disease which have been recently reported in a huge number in Indian bovine animals. And this first case was reported in India long back, but the idea was there have been cases since long in the regions of Africa. Now, there have been nodules across the body that develop, and sometimes these nodules open up and develop into wounds, and finally creating a difficult situation for the bovine animals. Around 10% mortality rate is seen with lumpy skin diseases. So far, there is no treatment for this viral disease as of now. Niacinates are used to treat and calm down the bovine animals to a certain extent. The next is equine herpes virus. Now, equine herpes virus, equine is a term which we use for horses. So recently, horses in Europe have got infected with the equine herpes virus. 7 countries in the region of Europe, mainly Spain, Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Sweden, and then in the regions of Arabian Peninsula, Qatar, have said that there have been cases of equine herpes virus which has been seen. The common, this is a kind of common DNA virus. COVID-19 is a RNA virus. Equine herpes is a DNA virus. So there are 5 variants. Equine herpes virus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And for domestic horses, 1, 3 and 4 are most serious. It is highly contagious. It can spread directly from one horse to another through the nasal secretion or the respiratory infection, and can also spread through physical contact with the contaminated virus. So precautions and anti-inflammatory drugs are taken. The next is an alternative anti-cancer therapy that has been devised, and this is by using transgenic zebra fish. This has been devised by Inspire under the Department of Science and Technology in India. So Inspire is an innovative program funded by DST, launched in 2008 with an idea that youth could communicate with creative ideas and bring in new concepts. So angiogenesis is not a new technique, but a physical form where new blood vessels are formed from the pre-existing blood vessels. So these are important in the growth of the cells where the blood supply is restricted. So after tumor, there is inhibition of the angiogenesis, and therefore there is basically inhibition of the blood vessels. And therefore, if this is brought into effect again, this can prove to be successful. So, angiogenesis inhibitors are important and they have unique cancer fighting properties which can be brought through this transgenic zebrafish platform which has been selected recently. The next is the Indian Ocean area. There are two things that have been going simultaneously. One is the genome mapping and the next is the aerial mapping. Genome mapping has been done by National Institute of Oceanography. The idea is Indian Ocean is the third largest ocean in the world with more than 20% of the Earth's water. So, samples of genome have been collected from the organisms in the Indian Ocean. And this has been done with a research vessel, Sindhu Sadhana, who has spent 90 days in the waters of nearly 10,000 nautical miles in Indian Ocean. Also, there have been various effects that have been seen, and the samples have been collected to a depth of around 5 kilometers. Mapping of RNA and DNA has been done, and this has made it very, very interesting project, because now we are able to have more and more copies of the genomes that can be studied in the Indian Ocean. Also, we are now mapping it with the airlines. So, the Andaman Nicobar Islands, the Lakshadweep Island, we have been doing aerial mapping. INCOSYS is the autonomous organization under the Ministry of Earth Sciences which has been working to provide advisory and guidance about the bathymetric study, the ocean-based study of Andaman Nicobar and Lakshadweep. Also, this has been working with NRSC, ISRO and Department of Space. There have been topographic airborne laser terrain mapping system which has been recognized, and an active remote sensing technology has been determined. Similar to this, there is another project which is with the Nippon Foundation of Japan and General Bathymetrics of Ocean Charting, which is Seabed 2030, which we have covered separately. The next is lithium ion technology. Now, this is one of an important developments, because with new developments, we have seen rechargeable batteries as lithium ion batteries. Now, these lithium ion rechargeable batteries, if we understand where this lithium has been found in huge amounts, Argentina is a place where we have largest reserves of lithium in the world. So, Kanchi Videsh is one of the companies in India which is trying to collaborate with the Argentine firms for future prospects of lithium in Argentina. Now, lithium ion, as we know, is one of the important batteries which can be used and which could be the future, can be used with electronic devices, electronic equipments, aerospace and industrial technology. There have been various advantages of using lithium ion batteries, but besides this, there have been issues which mainly relate to the longer charging time, and they are highly expensive in terms of manufacturing. So the first installation cost would be very, very high. But despite of this, we are trying to move to other options that can be possible. So what are the potential alternatives? We also have, besides the lithium ion battery, the option of fluoride battery, graphene battery, sand battery, ammonia powered battery. Also, we have solid state batteries which are now existing. The next is Mukundapura meteorite. Now, Mukundapura meteorite CM2 has been classified as carbonaceous chondrite and has been found to fell near the region of Mukundapura. So, Mukundapura is a village in close to Jaipur, and this was seen in 2017, and therefore it is known as Mukundapura meteorite, and it is mainly a carbonaceous chondrite. Now, there have been three types of meteorites. It can be either stony, it can be iron or stony iron in nature. Now, when we study the components, they are mainly aluminium, iron, magnetite, sulfide, which are seen as part of meteorite. Mukundapura is a stony meteorite which is seen, and it is again the fifth carbonaceous meteorite which actually fall into India. Now, next is Another important development, which is 2D electron gas. A ultra high mobility two-dimensional electron gas has been produced. And what is the idea? A electron gas is one which is free to move in two dimensions and is slightly confined in the third dimension. As a result, the energies are quantized and the level of motion in the third direction can be taken into account. So these electrons appear that they are a kind of two-dimensional sheet which are embedded in a three-dimensional world, and this is a two-dimensional electron gas. Very important development. This can bring in new avenues for electronic technology to develop. Also spinotronics can develop and enhance based on these. The next is Doppler weather radars. Now Doppler weather radars have been important. We have been installing numerous X-band Doppler radars for weather analysis. Two of the 10 that we have been developed indigenously in collaboration with ISRO. So ISRO along with Bharat Electronics have been manufacturing these radars. Now Doppler radars are specialized radars which produce velocity data for the object which are at distance. This can be either through a microwave signal at a desired target and bring in high accuracy. So the types of Doppler radars are basically 5, L, S, C, X and K. We have X-band radars. Two of those are indigenously built. These are very short range weather observations, and for short range weather observations we use X-band radars. Also they can help to pick up small turbulence or changes in the weather pattern. Tiny weather phenomena, water particles can be detected through these Doppler weather radar systems. The next is UV bright stars have been seen in the globular cluster in Milky Way galaxy called as NGC 2808. Now this has been discovered by Hubble telescope and Gaia telescope, and Hubble telescope, as we know, has been one of the major telescopes, the largest and the most versatile telescopes, established in low Earth orbit in 1990s. Gaia is another important space observatory launched by European Space Agency and has been important in measuring the position distance of the various stars. The next is understanding the various kind of developments in the star. So red dwarf is a near star to the sun. We have red giant, which is nearly 10 to 100 times that of the sun. White dwarf is usually small and hot star and usually the last cycle of the star. Then we have supernova neutron stars, which we have covered separately. The next important development is Open RAN architecture. Now Open RAN is an open radio access network, and this is a development that has been seen for mainly mobile networking. So a single vendor proprietary architecture has been developed, and it focuses on the communication system, which includes mobile phone, computers or any remotely placed equipment. So there are three important elements of RAN, which is the radio unit, distributed unit and centralized unit, and all of these function together in order to bring in the results. So another important development that we have seen is particulate matter 2.5, and particulate matter 2.5 have been linked to higher cases of anemia in children. With the forest fires, we have seen increasing amount of particulate matter 2.5 of the size of 2.5 microns that have been released, micrometers that have been released into the atmosphere, and if these are inhaled, nearly 63% of the children who have been exposed to particulate matter 2.5 were having the cases of anemia or decreased hemoglobin levels. Now with decreased hemoglobin levels, definitely growth would be affected, fatigue, lethargy would be some of the common symptoms that are seen. Government has launched numerous programs for anemia Mukt Bharat, and those are targeting to certain segments. Under this, iron and folic acid supplements have been given as part of the Anemia Mukt Bharat 2018 program. The next is most distant radio loud quasar has been studied with the European Southern Observatory very large telescope, and this has been discovered by a team of astronomers. Quasar is an abbreviation for quasi-stellar radio source, and the name means these are star-like emitters of radio waves, and these were first discovered in 1960s, the time where they basically started to emit ultraviolet rays, infrared rays or X-ray rays, and most of the quasars are actually much much bigger than the solar systems. So quasars have been studied since long and the significance have been important. Now as we understand quasars, these quasars can be two types. What we are talking now is a radio loud, the other is radio quiet. Radio quiet incorporates 90% of the quasars, and these quasars lack powerful jets and they have weak radio emissions in contrast to the radio loud, which constitute only 10% of the total quasars and have a very strong radio wavelength emission that can be seen. The next is first space military exercise by France, which is known as STRAX, and this basically focuses that France is the third largest space power after US and China. The space military exercises have been started by French and European armies together, and the idea is to create a new era in space development. Now whenever aircrafts crash, we have black box that is to be recovered. Now what is so unique about these black box? These black box leave ultrasonic waves, and even if they are underwater, because of those ultrasonic waves they can be detected where they have fallen. So black box is technically the flight data recorder. It records two things. It records the flight data and the cockpit voice. So cockpit voice is what the conversations have been between the cockpit members, and the flight data recorder maintains the speed, the altitude at which the plane was flying, the acceleration and the fuel flow. Now this is named as black box, but it is actually a orange color protected recording device which is developed, usually had magnetic tapes, but nowadays there are solid state memory boards that are used instead of memory tapes, and these also contain the crash survivable memory units. So they are equipped with the ultrasound systems, as we said, which is beacon, and they can keep emitting the ultrasound rays, the ultrasound waves for 30 days. And in the meanwhile, if this has been lost somewhere, it can be identified. Most of the cases, through the black box, we identify where and how the accident or the casualty actually took place. But these black boxes do not have video recording capability. It was only in certain cases, for example, the Malaysian airline crash, which was witnessed, that this black box was not recovered, and therefore has been an important concern then. Now there are various organizations which are related to aircraft security. International Civil Aviation Organization, Bureau of Civil Aviation Security and Aircraft Accident Investigation Bureau are some of those. The next is Asteroid 2001 F032. Now this has been predicted by NASA as one of the largest to pass by the Earth in 2021, and this would be the closest to the Earth as well. It was discovered nearly 20 years ago and has been one of the important asteroids which would be passing at a very fast speed, faster than the speed of normal asteroids that exist. Also, there have been numerous other asteroids which are mentioned here and are important. The next is the Square Kilometer Array Telescope. Now, Square Kilometer Array Telescope is one of the world's largest radio telescope which has been approved by the council, and this venture is important because the previous telescope, which was the Arecibo in Puerto Rico, has collapsed. So these radio telescopes have been important. They have a radio receiver and an antenna system. They are able to detect the radio frequency waves and cosmic rays, and therefore astronomical studies become very, very easier to get evolved, the studies of stars, galaxies and quasars with the help of radio telescopes. So Arecibo telescope, which was the previous one which collapsed in Puerto Rico, was established in 1963, and now we are talking about another, which is the Square Kilometer Array, which is also known as the SKA telescope. So SKA telescope or Square Kilometer Array is the name. It would be in Australia and Africa and would be a next step after the Arecibo telescope. So the functions are important: measuring and understanding the radio signals. The next is NASA's Mars Mission 2020. Again, a very, very important mission that we have already seen, and we have talked about the NASA's Mars mission separately. So, very important topic. Similarly, National Cybersecurity Strategy 2020 is important in line of the cybersecurity issues developing recently. Recently, a Chinese group of malware named as Red Eco developed a malware called as Shadowpad, and this was used to access the server's backdoor. So many of the vulnerabilities have been seen because of incorrect or hacks in the cyber platforms. Stone Panda in the IT infrastructure was another group of hackers from China who have been affecting the codes of Bharat Biotech and Serum Institute recently. So digital usage of the concepts have increased post COVID, and therefore cyber security again becomes important. Under this, phishing and frauds have increased. So eSIMs are now used. So eSIMs are an electronic version of the SIM or the subscriber identification module, which is embedded in the phone. It cannot be removed like a physical SIM card from the phone, and this is being created in order to have the phishing scams that can be taken into account. So RBI is focusing on more public awareness and EBAT, which is the electronic banking transfer electronic banking awareness and training programs for people, in order to avoid any threats or frauds that can occur because of the digital technologies that can affect their systems. So those were some of the important topics. We would be covering many more expected question series in the coming days in science and technology. So stay tuned for the upcoming sections and follow the link below for more details. Have a wonderful day ahead.